Hi, my name is Marisa Zanotti. I had written such an epic bio that I asked for it not to be read, so you can read it at your leisure in the guide for the symposium. I'm going to thank you so much to my two panel mates for setting up my presentation. I think there's lots of things we've got in common, and I hope that those things are going to become really apparent. But I'm going to talk to you today about working as an artist. I'm an artist researcher, and I'm going to be talking to you about working from an existing archive. And I was struck when I was preparing this presentation that the first time I seriously consulted an archive, I was interested in what was then known as video dance in, I think it was 1998. And I travelled from Scotland to London. I travelled 5.5 hours on a train to visit the place, to the video place, as it was then known. And I got there and they said, it's shut because of staff shortages. And I thought, wow, that as an experience of trying to access an archive and trying to access a physical archive is so different from the online archive that I'm going to speak about today. I'm going to talk to you about working from the archives of the 1970s dance group, UK dance group, Pans People. And their archive comprises of an official BBC archive held by the BBC, fan sites, an unofficial publicly maintained archive on YouTube of recordings of their performances on the weekly television programme Top of the Pops, and also other television programmes to do with pop music across Europe. And also their autobiography, Our Story. I also researched from Robert Graves' book, Greek Myths, and Anne Emmanuel Borger's feminist reading of stories about the nymph Echo. I also looked at a lot of paintings, and this is one of the extraordinary paintings that I researched in looking at who Pan was, and this is by Abram Govertz. So, In doing this project, I began to understand more about archives. And an archive is a curation. It's a living thing. It's unstable. It's always moving. It's incomplete. And an archive is generative. In a digital age, this process of movement becomes really more apparent and something that we as users become a part of. And the gaps in a vision and omissions become visible as content appears and disappears. In creating an artistic response to the archive of Pan's People, I've worked in the spaces, in the gaps and omissions, and also created a project that suggests its own gaps and omissions. So the Pan's People papers comprises of papers which are imagined as in lots of different forms, in the forms of filmed reconstruction of dances, academic papers, of which this is one, and online interventions. I'm going to focus on the first paper, which is a transmedia project called A Legion of Echoes. And this took place over 3 days in real time on Facebook and Twitter. And I'm going to finish my paper by speaking about the challenge of archiving that project in a way that speaks to its choreographic content and also speaks to the movement of its users around the archive, and perhaps also to the affective experience they might have in accessing that archive, because that feels, as a dance artist, like something that's very important to me. So why should we look at Pan's People at all? So for dance artists in the UK growing up in the 1970s, the weekly performances of Pan's People on the programme Top of the Pops were perhaps more important in terms of shaping their identity as dance artists, more than Hollywood musicals or more than broadcasts of dance performances. And they were often the most immediate example of dance that was available. And I know that this is true of other companies, of other countries who also have examples of popular dance groups appearing on popular music programmes. And the role of Pan's People on Top of the Pops was to present a choreographic adaptation of a record that was moving up the charts by an artist that couldn't be there that night on the recording. This was before the invention of the pop promo. And their choreographer, Flick Colby, I think, is one of the great unsung heroines of British dance, before she not only created the choreographies, but she also directed the camera. So she also directed the camera choreographies. She didn't choose the record she was choreographing, but this resulted in a mixture of very well-prepared, complex camera choreographies, and also perhaps less complex recordings where the record was changed on the day of the recording, and it was just people standing around and clapping. You can see that in Do You Wanna Dance, which I won't show you because it's dreadful. So I decided to work with a choreographer I'd worked with before called Lee Anderson. And we were looking for a starting point. How do we start this project to look at this dance company that we're both so excited about? And we decided that we would treat the recordings of the dances on YouTube as flawed documents that were in need of correction and remediation. We wanted to also free the dancers of any nostalgic viewing, because a lot of people in the UK who are over 40 have a lot of affection for Pan's people, and the archive elicits a lot of different responses: desire, embarrassment, and latterly horror and perhaps shame, and I'll talk about why that would be later. The correction initially happened through a reconstruction process in the studio with five dancers. And in this reconstruction process, our dancers are positioned as users of the archive, as experts in historical reconstruction, as they copy exactly what they see. So they copy only what they're seeing. So as much as the body is the subject of this archive and is the subject of these documents, the body also becomes an archiving technology as the individual interpretations of the dancers copying starts to become part of a new remediation. And I think that as an archiving tool is something that's very exciting. And I'm sure the people downstairs are talking about it. I had worked with this kind of method with Anderson before, because it grows out of her choreographic methodology, and she's over 30 years worked a lot with appropriation and reconstruction. But with this particular project, I wanted to extend that, because I had worked with her in my doctoral research, and I wanted to extend it by looking at the dances and asking, if they are documents, what else are they documents of apart from the choreography? And there are two research branches that emerged from this research. The first is that they're documents of technologies and televisual techniques of the 1970s on the BBC, and that's quite significant. Now, television was and continues to be driven by the imperative of keeping us watching. Television doesn't want us to change channels, and that's very complex now because we're watching television on a number of platforms at the same time, but then in the 1970s there was only one. And television keeps us watching and kept us watching through a technique which is identified in classical film theory as suturing. We are sewn into a narrative. In a film, we are sutured into a narrative through identifying with a protagonist. And the same thing happens in documentaries and in news reports. However, when there isn't a linear dramatic narrative in a pop programme in Top of the Pops, we're sutured into a different kind of narrative, one that we access through the gaze of a pop star. And we're sutured into a narrative that is perhaps our erotic fantasy with that pop star through the big close-ups of their gaze. But if there's no pop star there, and there was no pop star there sometimes on a Thursday night, what was the narrative going to be? We were sutured into a different kind of narrative, a dance narrative, a narrative that also we were kept watching by a screen that kept changing. We were mesmerised. And specific techniques were used: optical backdrops, moving cameras, shining costume, overlays, early use of chroma key, vision mixing. And here's an example of Pan's people and some of these techniques, and this is from a dance called You Little Trustmaker.
You little trust maker, you're no harm.
Thanks. So as you can see, there's a complexity to these which I'm going to open up. There's another aspect to these televisual techniques, and here a space opens up in the research to explore something that I argue is implicit but is not yet discussed in the recordings of Top of the Pops and Pan's People, and that's the magical origins of these particular techniques of moving cameras that mesmerise us so much. And these might be thought of in terms of glamour. And as you could see from the recording that I showed you, Pan's People were glamorous. They charm us, they invite us. But there's another sense of glamour here, and it's from the Scottish word glamour, which means a spell. And it's a spell which particularly affects the eyes, and it causes us to, it makes something appear different to what it is. Sometimes glamour appears as a haze. Sometimes it changes what the external reality of something. So I'm going to look at the effect of that glamour, for we did keep watching through the recordings of Top of the Pops, but there was something occluded. I mean, I was really attracted to these recordings, and I started this project during my PhD, and I was attracted to these fantastic performances, to the campery, to the sort of the joy and the innocence in the performances. But however, after I watched them for, there's hundreds of them, and I would be watching for 2 or 3 hours at a time. And I began to become increasingly uneasy because something felt not right, and I didn't know what it was. And then I started to look at the recording techniques. Shots of Pan's People were often from a low angle. The women were often dressed as little girls. And in the 1970s, this was a time when women's power was beginning to rise. Women had control over their bodies and their sexuality. We had the contraceptive pill. Women were in positions of authority in the workplace. And women, and in particular young women, had spending power. I began to ask, were Pan's People representative of everything that was wrong with the 1970s? And towards the end of 2012 and the beginning of 2013, something happened that made me understand fully my unease with what I'd been watching. So I'm going to show you the opening moments of You Little Trustmaker.
And what number is it?
Six.
Of course, I shall give you my scarf as a penance. Mea culpa, mea culpa, mea culpa. Fancy dropping two places. Ladies and gentlemen, the Times, Your Little Trustmaker, and of course, Pan's People.
And Jimmy Savile, for those of you that don't know, was revealed as a mass rapist and a paedophile, and somebody who was emerging out of a culture in the BBC of sexual harassment and sexual assault. The glamour, and that Jimmy Savile is being currently erased from the BBC archives. The glamour spell continues as he disappears from the BBC official archives, but reappears in the unofficial archive. And I'm asking, what does that do to my relationship to Pan's People? What does it do to our relationship to this archive, to this full archive? Who does it help? And Anderson and I, who had started with such joyful intentions, thought, how are we going to continue with this project? So we started to look at how we might salvage Pan's People, and I use salvage in the sense that Linda Hutchin uses it in her writing on adaptation, where she talks about adaptation as a process of appropriation and salvage. So I'm going to show you a short excerpt of a document that we corrected. So we reconstructed and corrected what we understood as the flawed original document of You Little Trustmaker with our dancers.
Thank you.
as you can see, we look at eye strain, the viewer's lecherous gaze with an accusatory stare. We corrected the casting in relation to gender. We used other techniques that we felt would correct this flawed documentation. Okay, great. Thanks. This is one of 120 posts in the 3-day event that was the Pans People Papers, A Legion of Echoes. So Lee and I wanted, when we started, we made that film in June, and then I proceeded to write a narrative around that looked at repositioning Pans People, and we decided to create a transmedia world looking to behaviours of dancers and choreographers on social media, where social media is a tool for promotion as well as a window into a creative process. The narrative locates Pans People in a parallel reality of Greek myth. In the last 3 days of rehearsal of a choreographer called Pan 15 and his dancers, including the nymph Echo, users could access this this piece through Facebook and Twitter by following Pan on Facebook and Twitter. So as much as possible, we wanted to make this a real story world, so we created adverts for Facebook by the Pan Global Corporation. I'd originally understood Pan as a powerful figure, as a god of riot and party, but I began to understand another kind of Pan, and the more I researched into painting, I found Pan and other satyrs in their pursuit, rape and assault of nymphs. And male painters through the ages have delighted in painting representations of these assaults. But I'm going to finish by saying two things. The first is that Pan's people didn't need rescuing. In 1976, they did what many dancers do. They moved on to other careers, and their final performance, Silver Star, sees them at their most beautiful, almost naked, no longer looking like little girls. They rise above us and the 1970s and leave us behind. Secondly, if you mess with Pan, you mess with a trickster. He messes with you. And our project was delivered through conductor software over 3 days in real time, and of course went out in the wrong order completely. So what had been conceived as a linear narrative that could be played with really went out in kind of quite a crazy way. So I'm now in the process of correcting my own archive and filling in the gaps. But also, I think that an archive of A Legion of Echoes should mesmerise its users. And I'm now writing the archive and beginning to find a programmer that I can work with for an archive that renews itself, that destroys itself, that mutates, that encourages its user to alter it, and that an archive that celebrates the movement and instability inherent in all archives, a glamorous archive. Thank you.